the last and number 9 tape of the interview of Oscar Hoffman. At this concluding part of our discussion, I'd like to ask you about your first impressions of Australia in 1956.
For our impression on Australia, imagine that we arrived from Paris, which is a world-known city, but with all the greatness of Paris, we were living with 2 kids in a we can call it a 1.5 bedroom apartment, which was on the first floor of a building where the facilities were not only downstairs but out of the building in the yard. But it was Paris. So to say that Australia wasn't a shock to me, if I can express it as a shock, the astonishment of finding that I arrived to my sister, which lived in a place where the floors were covered with felt, you know, the material with which the hats are made, felt. It's not carpet, but it's not lino either, it's felt. For me to have seen felt on the floor, I didn't know whether I should walk on my head or whether it's possible to walk on felt. In other words, we had a lino on the floor and that was it. And as I say, no facilities except that we had water and gas in the place. So for us, it was really something we couldn't even imagine. Naturally, when it came down to the life wasn't exactly what you had in Paris. So, as I said before, for my wife to have sacrificed to follow me, because it was my wish to come here, for her it was a big decision to do. And to find the place, it was really from Paris to Melbourne, it's really like the earth and the sky. In Paris there is no such an hour of the day where there is no people in the street and lightings and so. Where in here, when we arrived, especially 41 years back, the pubs were closing at 6 o'clock, and it's not that I ever visited the pubs, but the rest of the life was in comparison. Pictures, even you had to queue up for long queues, and it wasn't exactly the life after having tasted the life of Paris, but comfort-wise and how should I say, life was much easier. Unfortunately, I happened to bring with me unpleasant surprises that on the way here we came by ship. Actually, it was the last ship, the last trip of an Italian ship, which was called Suriento, that we came. As I say, it was in 1956, that was the last ship also which passed through the Suez Canal, because after that the Suez Canal was closed, and at that time already we were advised. I didn't have a passport, I had a stateless act only. My wife had a French passport, but we were advised not to go up the ship at Suez Canal already, because the French weren't the best mates of Nasser, who was in power at that time. So we arrived here, and as I say, yes, there I wanted to get it is that on the ship already I had some discomfort passing my urine, and I went to the ship doctor and explained to him what I had, and I happened to mention to him I need this and this, because that symptom started with me 2 or 2.5 years previously in Paris. Naturally, I went to a doctor, he prescribed me a tablet, and it wiped it off. 2 years later, I had the same thing. I knew where to go. I had a God, so I went back, and he gave me something else. And if the first time it lasted for 2 years, the second time only lasted maybe 6 months, and it plied then, it plied up while I was on the way here. So I arrived here and went here to a doctor with my complaint, and again I told him I need this and this because of my record from past. And naturally, he made me understand that it's not all, that he'll give me something that he thinks is right for me. And so, anyhow, he gave me something and assured me that he'll wipe out my symptoms forever, not only for 6 months or for 2 years. But just in case it does not happen, to come back in a week's time, I went back in a week's time, and they again knocked on my shoulders, don't worry, I'll fix you for good. The second time around didn't work, so my sister decided to take me to another doctor, which again told me straight out that he can give me a tablet which will wipe it off straight away, but it won't be a lasting thing. He sent me for tests, like blood test and urine test, and told me, once you have your test done, come back and I'll give you a prescription, and I guarantee you that in 24 hours your symptoms will be over, but I will know from the results what the trouble is. It's really that why it happened, that I came back and he gave me the thing and it worked. Naturally, the conclusion was that I had a stone in the ureter, which with the time that the other doctor dragged me with the medication, that stone blocked the ureter, which in turn blocked the kidney from functioning. So my start in here was that I think I was here for 6 weeks and finished in hospital having the stone removed. When the stone was removed, the kidney started functioning again. In other words, the strangulation was released, the kidney started functioning again, but the cut didn't heal because the tuberculosis was set in the kidney already from not functioning for a period. So I was, I can say I was working maybe for 6 weeks in the country. When I finished in the hospital, From one operation to another, from hospital to sanatorium, and then back to hospital, I was for 1.5 years off work. And even when I restarted work, I had to go every second day for injections, and that was my start in here. Luckily, we arrived at my sister's, so we lived with them. My wife started working at home, doing machining. People brought work in for her and picked it up, and that's how we went on living.
And if I could just ask you, what did you think of the Australian people that time, those first few years?
The Australian people were, to start with, I didn't have the language, so I had very little contact with Australian people. But I didn't have any bad encounter with any Australian whatsoever. I can only have praise for them. But as I say, I didn't have the language, so I hadn't had that really experience that I could have gained to be able to answer such a question.
Finally, if we're going to look back at the whole time of the Holocaust in the 30s and the time of the war. Do you think, is there a lesson or a message for the younger generation?
The message is that you can't relax, you can't take anything for granted. The freedom you have today can be curtailed by tomorrow, and you have to be on the lookout because you don't know who will hit you tomorrow or what might happen.
And the question of being Jewish, has that changed in your mind at all?
No, if anything, it reinforces it, but not in the religious sense. I am less believer that I was as a child, because as a child I took it for granted that my father is doing the prayer, so I have to do it, but I didn't even question it. It was just an adoption. Where today, after having gone through all that, it got me cold. In other words, I still traditionally go to shul on Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah, but otherwise I have very little religious vice. It doesn't mean that my son is a fanatical Lubavitch follower. On the other hand, my daughter doesn't want to listen anything about it. In other words, the two extremes from the same tree. But there again, it's their life, because they are no more children. As children, naturally, I didn't instill in them what I didn't have. In other words, I cannot boost that I gave them the feeling of the Jewishness, because I didn't practice it more than going to the synagogue on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, or sometimes even in Pesach. But my son took the opposite side of it. From the day he got bar mitzvah, he became frum, and he doesn't want to let go. He's hanging on to God's foot. As for my daughter, I would be glad if she would have a little bit of feeling for her religion so that she can pass it on to her daughter, but there is nothing whatsoever.
Thank you very much. Mr. Hoffman, can you tell us about this photo, please?
This photo is a reconstructed picture from a very old, broken picture of my father.
And what year would that have been taken?
I'm just guessing that it could have been in 40, maybe 38, 40. But just guessing.
Good, thank you. And who is this imposing figure on the photograph?
This is my late mother, just before the war.
In the late 1930s?
Maybe even in the 40, 42.
Good, thank you. And this photograph?
This is an identity picture of myself in 45.
Taken whereabouts?
In Paris already.
Thank you. And this close-up of a handsome young gentleman?
This is again a picture of me, maybe a year later.
Thank you. And this photo?
This is my brother in 1945.
And how old would he have been?
He would have been 24.
And in which city was that taken?
That was in Sziget.
Thank you. And can you tell us, please, about this photograph?
This photograph was taken at my older sister's wedding, who is in white, my mother in the center. Next to her, the the husband of my sister, who was a Mr. Schwartz. Behind my mother is my younger sister. The rest is family and friends.
Thank you. And can you tell us, please, who this charming couple is?
This is my second sister's wedding with her husband, Fake Froyum.
In what year would that have been?
That could have been in 49, maybe even further, I don't remember. In 48?
In Paris, was it?
No, that was in Siget again.
Siget again.
Yeah.
Thank you. And can you please tell us about this photo?
This photo is referring during my speech to the intellect and rich family relations which went with us to camp. That is cousins of my mother. My mother is behind in the center. In front of her is her brother, and the other two couples are the cousins.
And what year would that have been?
That was before the deportation. It could have been in the 42 maybe.
Thank you. And is this a family shot?
Yes, this is an auntie of mine with her two daughters. She is a good man from my father's sister.
Thank you. And can you tell us, please, about this photo?
This photo is a sister of the previous one, which is the second sister of my father.
Good, thank you. And the young family in this photo?
This is again my older sister with her husband and daughter.
Thank you. And this photo?
This photo is actually the grave of my brother at the spot where he happened to fell.
Thank you. This is the identity card of...
This is the identity card of my brother, which was in a kibbutz at that time.
And this is the identity card of your...
This is the identity card of my brother, who belonged to kibbutz Dagania.
Thank you. This is the metzeva of...
The metzeva of the actual brother who was buried at the Mount Herzl.
Thank you. Can you please tell us about this handsome couple?
This picture was done on our wedding day in 1949.
In Paris?
In Paris.
Thank you. This photo is?
Our son's graduation.
Your son's name again is?
Samuel.
Good. Thank you. And this photo of the two children?
Happened to be Samuel's two children, two boys, Israel and Jacob.
Thank you. And this photo of the two charming young women?
Happened to be Veronica and her mother,
Regina.
Thank you.
I forgot my own daughter's name.
Mr. Hoffman, can you please tell us about the lovely young lady next to you?
The young lady next to me happened to be my wife for the last 48 years. She happened to marry a Holocaust survivor.
And can you please, for the benefit of our future viewers, introduce your wife?
My wife, darling Elian, whom I collected in Paris, and pleased me to come to Australia.
Thank you very much.